Welcome to my channel, INTJ Island. Today, I'm going to talk about five things INTJ students wish their teachers and their parents knew. First, group activities do not activate us. They shut us down. A group is a collection of independent people forced to act as if they were a unit. It is temporary, and once it breaks apart, what it accomplished has no meaning to an INTJ. He wants to do something himself, for himself. His joy in any activity is found in what he has learned that is important to him, and what he has accomplished, rated against his internal standard of excellence. A group activity strips away the most important aspects of learning, or doing, for an INTJ. Even worse, he is cast into an environment that he will almost certainly find uncomfortable. He does not naturally work well with others. His mind is focused on his intuitive picture of patterns as to what is real, or better yet, possible, in the world, as his extroverted thinking organizes his actions in a way where he can accomplish what he wants to get done. Working with a group of extroverts is like trying to build a house of cards with a fan blowing across the table. He can't possibly attain his peak performance. In addition, if he has a high IQ, which is fairly likely, the INTJ will be working with people who are unable to keep up with his mental processes. He is held back by the group from doing what he would otherwise be able to accomplish. Look at it like this. You have a thoroughbred racing horse, and you tie him to a team of Clydesdales. What sort of sense does that make? The slow-moving, strong horses will pull more weight, but they will hold the racehorse back. It will highlight the weaknesses of the individual members. Every personality type, every individual, has a set of skills, tendencies, and abilities. For an INTJ, he will almost certainly be motivated by how well he functions as an individual, and not how well he works with a group. This solitary approach is a basic need, not just a choice. An INTJ is wired to judge his own accomplishments in life, and a teacher, if he wants to be effective, must connect into that individualistic powerhouse that the INTJ has, and not weigh him down by dragging a group along on his shoulders. It is far more likely that he will disconnect from the group and let the group fail than for him to try and coax the others along or to turn their chaos into order. Personally, even as an adult, what I have done with a group is either take the entire load and push the others out of the way, or carve out some part of what is being done and do it alone. The reason groups are formed ostensibly is to gather in the abilities of several people to combine them into an effective tool to accomplish something. What it really is a mechanism of covering up the failings of some of the members while the others, possibly a single individual, ends up carrying the bulk of the load. If you are riding on the backs of others, or you are there to socialize rather than work, group activities look great. But if you are the one doing the work, not so much. On the other hand, if I can push the others in a group out of the way and do it all myself, I will engage in the project with my full ability. What I then have effectively done is to convert the group task into a solitary one. As long as the others don't get in the way, I can tolerate that. I have done this a number of times in my life. But if I have to waste time pulling others along, I naturally will check out of the process. Number two, if we look like we are a million miles away, what you are saying is not engaging our minds. A teacher has a mission statement to follow, to teach the students in the room a certain well-defined amount of material. It may be a skill, theoretical knowledge, or conceptual facts about some topic. The first goal for any good teacher is to tie the material together with something in real life so that the student can picture what the information in the lesson will be used for. For example, you don't study grammar in order to know grammar. You study grammar so that you can construct proper sentences. Why? So you can convey information clearly. so that you don't appear to be an uneducated buffoon when you apply for a job. So that you will have tools to write short stories, novels, biographies, or even letters home to mom and dad. You want to make sure that you don't write something that is unclear. Communication is critical to many parts of life, and it would do the student a world of good if he knew that this particular aspect of grammar that you are going to study today will help him to do what he wants to do in the future. It is not just a rule he needs to learn in order to pass a test. Tests are completely unimportant, while being able to use what you know is extremely important. The INTJs are great at scoring high on tests usually, but that is not what drives them. They want to know the why as well as the what. When it comes to homework or major projects, if you want to get the very best effort out of an INTJ, make it matter to his future in some way. We love the future, and anything we can do right now that we know will make the future better is something that we can truly care about. If a teacher is in front of a classroom teaching a subject, that subject is being presented for a reason. Someone has determined that the students need to learn this material. For an INTJ, he needs to understand that reason, and he has to buy into it as being valuable, or he may very well find something far more interesting inside his own mind to think about. Or he might be working out an interesting math problem in his notebook while the teacher is talking about poetry. Make it appear very important, or don't bother doing it at all. Number 3. A lack of progress along your desired learning track doesn't mean that we are stupid. An INTJ, given the right circumstances, might set his own course in what he is learning. My first time through sixth grade was incredibly educational for me. I read one biography after another, and I still find myself referring back to some of the things I learned that year. However, my report card showed straight Fs in more than one subject, and the final grade is being F in several others. I was told by my parents that the school informed them that I should be at the top of my class, and so my father, naturally, yelled at me when I brought the report cards home. That wasn't pleasant, of course, but then no one said anything until the next card came home with me. Things at home were a mess. My folks were having trouble with my father's drinking, and so my grades were not all that high on anyone's priority list. The teacher was in her first year of teaching, and she never took me aside and asked me what was wrong. She had a quiet kid in the back of her classroom. I didn't cause trouble. I occupied my own mind, and she had no idea how to deal with an INTJ who was completely disconnected from her presentations. That year, in effect all the years up until seventh grade, didn't need to be the way they were. I could easily have learned the material, but no one took the time to help me understand why I should learn the material. As far as they were concerned, I was like a car broken down on the side of the freeway, and they were all driving past me, hardly noticing I was sitting there. And, in my car, I had a universe of things to think about, and traveled light years farther than the class did, and so I didn't notice them either. In seventh grade, we moved to Barstow, California, which had a small school with a great teacher, and he took the time to get my mind into the subjects he was teaching. Suddenly, I had 5 A's on my very first report card, and it completely changed my course for school. I had never had an A before, not one. My dad nearly fell over in shock when he saw the card. A little side note, my teacher's name was Mr. Nicholas, and to me, because of all the good things he did for me, could accurately be called St. Nicholas. He also did something that was in some ways even more surprising than improving my academic accomplishments. He got me to engage with the class, at least more than I ever had done before. As I said, the school was in Barstow, California, and that city is located in the Mojave Desert. The desert was dry, of course, but it was also very windy. The ground was flat for miles in every direction, and there was nothing to disrupt the motion of the air. It is a lot like the ocean where the wind flows smoothly with no resistance, and so it can reach high velocities. Tumbleweeds would fly along the ground at breakneck speed. You had to watch to make sure they didn't clog up the vents in your radiator when you hit them. There were no trees to speak of. If you gave them some water, palm trees would thrive, but grass lawns were a luxury you had to pay to water. A number of homeowners had laid down gravel and painted it green to simulate grass. Naturally, our playground in this small school was dirt and it had no grass, and we took a lot of bad hops from the ground balls on the ball field. But the wind could get up to 70 miles per hour or more. That would be over 112 kilometers per hour for the rest of the world. Everything was built low to the ground, from houses to shrubbery. It was also a dry land as far as you could see. The hills around us were naked of any growth. On one hill, I could easily read the huge white letters, Calico. It was the Calico ghost town, located in those hills, doing some advertising. When the wind was up near hurricane strength outside, it seemed like a good idea to stay inside for our recess breaks. Mr. Nicholas decided to buy a ping pong table for the classroom, and we all got to play during our breaks. There were only 10 kids, and so there was no problem with all of us getting a turn for short games. I'd never played the game before, but I picked up the rules quickly and practiced every chance I got. I loved it. Mr. Nicholas gave us a goal to reach. I also love goals. He said if any of us could beat him in a game to 21, the class would take the rest of the day off and do nothing but play ping pong. That got me excited. Three times a day, the class had a little elimination tournament, once for the morning recess, once at lunch, and once in the afternoon. And at the end, the one who won the tournament would play Mr. Nicholas. One day, I finally beat him. It was great because it happened at the morning break. The entire class was jumping around and celebrating and patting my back. I was the class hero, at least for the moment. I was so amazed that I had won. When he wanted an immediate rematch, I lost the game. I was so excited about winning, I just knocked the ball back and forth. I mean, we had the rest of the day off to play ping pong. But that rematch was the last time I ever lost a game to him. I had improved to the point where from then on, I won them all. Mr. Nicholas had pulled me into the class, and I was really a part of the class for the first time in my life. I later on learned to play table tennis a lot better, and it became one of my favorite sports. It was a gift that I have not only enjoyed personally, but I've had my entire family involved in playing the game as well. It is hard to properly praise a teacher like that. He did so much to alter my life in positive ways. I can't thank him enough. And this is something every teacher could be doing for students. If you are a teacher, there's a very strong possibility that you have a high horsepower mental engine sitting under the hood for a student sitting in your classroom. He will be gazing off into space when you are speaking if you haven't engaged his mind. Make your material matter to his mind. Show why he needs to know this, and you will probably be amazed at the high-end performance that you will get in response. If you do that, you'll never be sorry you made that effort. And you may have a student, just like me, who will remember you fondly even after 54 years have gone by. A good grade is not what we are after. An INTJ is sitting in your classroom to learn something valuable. If he has a bad track record from earlier grades, as I had, you need to address that proactively and not with whips and chains and abuse, but talk to him like an adult. You might find that in some ways that is exactly who you are talking to. INTJs early on get a sense of self that most students don't come to until years later. They of course don't have anything approaching a full worldview in the early grades, but I bet they are working on it already. We want things to make sense. That is what we are after. Sure, it is great that pi is an irrational number, but so what? First of all, how can that be? Here is a number that is impossible to predict what its next digit will be until you calculate it out. You know it will never repeat, and it will never reach the end. In a way, this can appear to be a miracle. You might trigger an INTJ into a true passion for digging deep into pi or irrational numbers generally. You might suggest that perhaps since pi is the ratio between the circumference of a circle and its diameter, It is a fundamental characteristic that either the circumference or the diameter must be irrational themselves. If not, the ratio would also be rational. What makes it work? You could easily send an INTJ into an intellectual world of discovery where he will learn amazing things that he will take with him for the rest of his life. Alternatively, you could give a lame answer like, "Oh, that is just how it is. Now let's move on." Bad teachers do that a lot. Also, I think many teachers are playing out of their own league with an INTJ student. He may well have an IQ that is 30 points or more higher than your own, and if you are not willing to help that INTJ, despite the fact he may very well surpass you, perhaps even this very year, you are not a good teacher. Think how proud you would have been to have taught Sir Isaac Newton before he worked his magic on the world. Sure, he is way smarter than you are, but so what? You helped him to grow into who he became. There is always someone smarter than you are. That's okay. You are not in competition with your students. You are their coach, and you help them to become superstars. You will share a part in their future as you today tend to the present. When I was growing up, my father always told me that he hoped that I would be bigger and stronger and smarter than he was. And he meant it. I ended up 4 inches taller, and at least I could give him a run for his money on intelligence. But not a day of his life would I have felt at all safe trying to match my muscles against his. He was incredibly strong. Even as an adult, I was never his match. Now, both of my sons, his grandsons, could have given him a run for his money. The oldest one has a body build that is scary in how close it matches up with my father's. In fact, one time I was showing him a picture of myself and my father from the rear when I was young, and my son finally got a chance to see what I had been seeing. His jaw dropped and he said, "That could have been me standing there." And he was right, it could have been. My younger boy is taller, but he too is very strong. I have said for years, if I ever get into a brawl, I want my boys on my side of it. In any case, a good teacher will accept a fantastic student as a blessing and will do all he can to push that student forward to grab the brass ring. When you are coaching, what matters is how well you get others to play. You want them to play better than you do. You take pride as a teacher or a coach in the fact that you did your part to not only not hamstring a great mind or a great athlete, but to nurture and to promote them to reach their peak performance. If a teacher can't do that, he is in the wrong profession. You are not there to show how smart you are, but to show how much help you can give to move every student to operate into the range of his maximum ability to learn. This is your mission. It is your prime directive for your classroom. Grades are not something of value in and of themselves. A good grade only means something when it shows that a student has not only written a paper that you agree with, but he has written a paper that shows he knows what he is talking about and can express his views powerfully and clearly. It isn't rote learning, it is understanding. Then and only then have you done your job as you should have. Number 5, INTJs are consumed with a burning desire to learn. You need to hook into that if you want to teach us. This is a problem that great teachers knock a solution for clear out of the park year after year. Right up front, they establish the foundation for the course, and then they do it again for each lesson. Today, we are going to go over some basic properties in algebra. We are going to start with the identity property, where it is stated that A equals A. To a thinking mind, it is simply stating the obvious, as though it were profound. Of course, something is going to be the same as itself. It is so fundamentally obvious that it is like saying you are sitting in your chair, and therefore, you are sitting in your chair. Duh. However, this is placed right at the very bottom of the foundation for all equations. For what is on one side of the equal sign must be identical in value to that which is on the other side of the equal sign. A is always equal to A. It is impossible for A to be equal to not A. This leads to the idea that what is on one side of the equal sign, even if it is in a different form, is still equal to what is on the other side. In fact, if some expression equals A, it can be replaced by A, and it reverts back to A equals A. This is a clear expression that A doesn't change into something else just because it moves to the other side of the equal sign. You then move forward to if A equals B, then B equals A. Again, this transitive property seems obvious, but it is also foundationally important. If something is equal to A, they are, in effect, interchangeable. Later on, you find that this is done a lot in mathematics, where you replace one thing with an expression that is of equal value. These concepts will be applied over and over again in mathematics. When numbers and expressions replace the single letters, these properties still apply. So if you write A equals some complex expression, you know that the two sides of the equation represent exactly the same value. This is a powerful tool that pervades all of mathematics, physics, engineering, and any other area of knowledge and creative invention that uses mathematics to calculate what will be done. If an INTJ knows this, then he will pull in the idea of A equals A like a trapeze artist grabs onto the bar in midair as being something extremely important. Moving on, you find that if A equals B and B equals C, then A equals C. These things are not just silly little statements of the obvious that appear like a waste of time to go over. There's no coincidence that Ayn Rand had John Galt begin his speech by pointing out how important it is philosophically to accept the fact that A equals A, and it never equals not A. It is a misconception to think that INTJs are hard to teach. They are not. What is hard is to find a teacher who is willing to search out the reason to learn something and make it clear to the students before presenting the material. Not some lame sugar puff reason either. It has to have some meat to it, so that it rings true and opens the door to envisioning what it will mean to the student to possess this incredible gift of knowledge that is about to be presented. Have you ever walked a large dog who wanted to run when you wanted to walk? He is pulling at the leash and trying to drag you along. Just picture the mind of a student, an INTJ student, who has gotten the scent of something that is important and will be soon coming into his grasp. Any teacher who addresses these five items I have talked about today is going to have just as hard a time keeping up with the INTJ who is ready to kick in the afterburners to acquire the knowledge he realizes is there. The biggest problem a teacher will usually have is dealing with all the questions demanding more and more knowledge. The INTJ wants to know everything about a topic he is interested in. Everything. If you enjoyed this video, please click like. And if you haven't subscribed yet, please do. I'll see you next time.